technical difficulties, or actually batteries may be in backwards. Well, good morning and welcome in Jesus' name. It's good to be gathered together and to worship our Lord and Savior, and it's fun to drive in knowing that Sunday school is rolling now and some different things that way. And good to see all of you here. And God has us each here for a purpose. So that's a neat thing that he's going to talk to each of us today through his word. If you take out your bulletin, there's a few things to note there. There's a full slate of things going on this week with youth group tonight, and then the Dorcas and youth groups going on, or Dorcas and Ruth groups. I do want to remind you about Wednesday evening with Young Explorers and confirmation taking place. We are also doing that the Bible study Mysterious Hope. We just started it last Wednesday. You can come on in anytime. It's for youth and adults. We are listening to some of the speakers from a summer ago at our Fly Beyond, which is a Free Lutheran Youth event, and talking about that hope that we have in Christ. And so that was really good to do that this past week, and I encourage you to do that as well, or come if you could. There will be, Joyce is going to have ice cream sundaes there and stuff too. So if any of you men need to find a cheap date for your wife, you can come in that way. I do it, so hey. Also in the bulletin, just a reminder with upcoming events, I want to keep in front of you a couple different things. One, the Spruce Fall Sale is coming up a week from this coming Friday. Out at Spruce, it's good to be able to do that again and to have that opportunity in that way. All right, we want to try her? I'm live, okay. In your bulletin, you have a purple insert and a green one, I believe, or a tan one. The tan one I want to keep in front of you. Just keep that date in front of you with the Reawakening Conference. It's an opportunity for you to come and to meet many of the leaders within the AFLC. And they are going to provide breakfast and dinner for you, too. So, again, guys, if you need another date excuse, there you go with things. But it will be a wonderful opportunity to see that they're just people like us. And it'll be neat for you to have that opportunity. The purple insert has a couple of the women's events that are coming up. And just want to remind you about those. Well, one, the women event of the WMF rally, the Women's Missionary Federation rally that will come up in October, but just so you can put that date down. And then on the back of that is Moms in Prayer. If you are interested in being a part of that as a mom or a grandma, to be praying for the students at school, you see the opportunity that's there in front of you. The up close event at our Free Lutheran Bible College will be taking place October 21st and 22nd. So if there's any juniors or seniors that you know of, that would be interested, or graduates that might be interested in going to college at our Free Lutheran Bible College in Plymouth, Minnesota, there's that opportunity. Some of these brochures are on the back as well, but it's for juniors and seniors, and parents and youth leaders are welcome as well to go down and visit our campus. Anytime you're down in the Twin Cities, feel free to stop by the campus. And just to visit, see the new Student Life Center that's up as well. And they'll take you around and give you a tour so you can see where students are in that way. We have right now one student down there. Our son Kyle is going to school there. We will have some student or perhaps students next year going as well. I've filled out at least one. Evan, I filled out yours the other day, so you're registered, but good opportunity if you do that. Prayer list is on the back of the outline in the bulletin. I encourage you to be praying. I have a few for you to add or just to update on some of those. One is Diane Kastner. That would be Bruce Schmeichel's mom. Just went on hospice, so you can be in praying for Diane. I believe she's still out at the Rices if things are going that way, but be in prayer for Diane and the family that way. Ron Tramer's sister, who's in the bulletin, she's not expected to make it through the week here. She's been dealing with the cancer and things. They didn't expect her to make it through this weekend, but you can be in prayer for the family in that way. And I'm forgetting one more. Ruby Dibadal's sister, and I'm forgetting her first name, our sister-in-law, will be having surgery for pancreatic cancer on the 23rd of this month. So you can be in prayer for Ruby's sister-in-law. And I'm forgetting the first name. There were no bulletins in the back either, so that's a good sign. All of them are getting used up. Any other prayer requests or prayer praises?
I have an announcement.
Sure, yes. Come on up. Hit the mic. Well, use the mic, Shirley. I always love your announcement too, so it's good.
Okay, we only have 10 weeks to go, and Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes are due. So that makes it about 70 days to start packing. But the main thing is to pray, shop, pack. So in 2 weeks, I'll have a display back there. You can help yourself. I have plastic shoeboxes in my garage, plus paper shoeboxes. There's a few of us that have been packing all or shopping all summer. So my husband would like his basement back, but that's okay. He can get it back later. Last year we did a total of 208 boxes. So this will be year number 5. The first year we made 99. So I think my goal should be 220 this year. And then 9,113,853 children got to hear the word of God last year. That's how many boxes were turned in. Okay, this is the same age level, boy and girl, 2 to 4, 5 to 9, 10 to 14. And I know a lot of you don't want to pack a box, but if you want to contribute towards a donation box, we will gather up all that stuff and pack a nice box for the kids. I have these brochures here for the little kids if they want to fill them out. I know that the kids can't read our English, but they'd like to have a picture of you or if you want to draw a picture. It's kind of a neat little thing. I'll put that back there too. But there's one announcement I have to make. Whoever packed last year in the boxes a disposable drinking cup, please let me know where you got them. That was the neatest thing to put in because most of the kids have to cup their hands together to drink. And that little cup didn't take up much room, and we'd like to have more if we can get them. Okay? Any other questions? You can ask Pastor Todd. He'll be able to answer them.
And my answer will be call Shirley. So what a wonderful thing to consider that God's word got out like that. And thank you, Shirley, for heading that up each year as well. Let's pray. Let's talk with God. Lord, as we've heard Shirley talk here, we thank you that those opportunities take place, and we pray ahead of time for these boxes that will be put together. Use them, Lord, and use the word that goes with them, and may it be just one small way we can show our love to the world around us and to the people around us. We pray as we think of our list and see all the different needs that are out there, just lift the different people before you, the different hurts, the different desires that are there. And we pray for physical healing. We pray for the healing of hearts. We pray for Diane Kastner and her family. We just lift her before you. We pray for Ron Tramer's family with his sister and ask that you'd especially be with them right now. We pray as well that you would help each one of us to just take steps forward each day and to walk knowing that you walk ahead of us. I pray for the service today, that the music that's sung, the words that are shared, and we claim the promise, your word will not return empty. Help us to hear that word today. And oh Holy Spirit, touch our hearts so that we will respond and you will do that work. Thank you, Jesus. I pray these things in your wonderful name. And Lord, if there's anything I've forgotten or people, we just put it all in your hands today. Amen. Let's stand together and sing our opening song. And We went a little bit Swedish this morning with Children of the Heavenly Father here, but it fits in with what we're going to take a look at. And I pray that you are a child of God's as we sing this wonderful song. Please be seated. As we sang the fourth verse of that song, it talked about how our protector never slumbers. Gets me to thinking back 20 years ago, September 12th. We would have woke up that next morning after September 11th, and some of us may have been wondering if our protector was still there or if God was still around. We know He is. And we know He walks with us. September 11th, 20 years ago, kids, was quite a day for many of us as our nation was attacked, and you probably heard of those things. I had the privilege yesterday of being in the very spot I was when I heard about things. I was at my former church at a 40th anniversary down in Lakeville, Minnesota, and was reminded of that day. I was with many of the same staff members that I was with that day. And we were reminded of what happened. And we had a prayer service that evening with the Lakeville police and firemen and a lot of different things. And our world has changed ever since. But God has not. He still is our protector. For confession of sin today, we're going to sing a song. I've been thinking this past week about how we need Him every hour, don't we? We need Jesus. And this will serve as a confession as well as a proclamation that He's there for us. So let's sing this wonderful song, I Need Thee Every Hour. May it be our prayer today as a prayer of confession and a prayer of knowing that Jesus is there for us.
I need Thee every hour, most gracious Lord. No tender voice like Thine can peace afford. I need Thee, oh, I need Thee. Every hour I need Thee, oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to Thee. I need Thee every hour. Stay Thou nearby. Temptations lose their power when Thou art nigh. I need Thee, oh, I need Thee. Every hour I need Thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to Thee. I need thee every hour in joy or pain. Come quickly and abide, or life is vain. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee, oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour. Teach me thy will and thy rich promises in me fulfill. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee. Oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee. I need thee every hour, most holy one. Oh, make me thine indeed, thou blessed Son. I need thee, oh, I need thee. Every hour I need thee, oh, bless me now, my Savior. I come to thee.
I'll call upon our scripture reader at this time to come on up.
There are three readings this morning. The first one is in the book of Numbers, chapter 11, verses 26 through 30. However, two men whose names were Eldad and Medad had remained in the camp. They were listed among the elders, but did not go out to the tent. Yet the Spirit also rested on them, and they prophesied in the camp. A young man ran and told Moses, "Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp." Joshua, son of Nun, who had been Moses' aide since youth, spoke up and said, "Moses, my lord, stop them." But Moses replied, "Are you jealous for my sake? I wish that all the Lord's people were prophets, and that the Lord would put his Spirit on them." Then Moses and the elders of Israel returned to the camp. The second reading is from the book of 1 Kings, chapter 18, verses 36 through 40. At the time of the sacrifice, the prophet Elijah stepped forward and prayed, "O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel and that I am your servant and have done these things at your command. Answer me, O Lord, answer me, so the people will know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you are turning their hearts back again." Then the fire of the Lord fell and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, and the soil, and also licked up the water in the trench. When all the people saw this, they fell prostrate and cried, "The Lord, he is God! The Lord, he is God!" Then Elijah commanded them, "Seize the prophets of Baal. Don't let anyone get away." They seized them, and Elijah had brought them down to the Kishon Valley and slaughtered there. Third reading is from the book of Luke, chapter 9, verses 46 through 56. An argument started among the disciples as to which of them would be the greatest. Jesus, knowing their thoughts, took a little child and had him stand beside him. Then he said to them, "Whoever welcomes this little child in my name welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. For he who is least among you all, he is the greatest." "Master," said John, "we saw a man driving out the demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he is not one of us." "Do not stop him," Jesus said, "for whoever is not against you is for you." As the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. And he sent messengers on ahead who went into a Samaritan village to get things ready for him. But the people there did not welcome him because he was headed for Jerusalem. When the disciples James and John saw this, they asked, "Lord, do you want us to call the fire down from heaven and destroy them?" But Jesus turned and rebuked them, and they went to another village.
Thank you, Tim, for reading that today. And we're going to look at that Luke 9 passage again, and the other ones, you'll see how they fit in those regards as we take a look at things. Let's proclaim and let's confess our faith today. We'll use the Apostles' Creed like we so often do, and again, may it come from your heart as we proclaim what we believe. So join me if you would. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let's continue by giving back to God with our tithes and offerings here today. Gracious God, thank you again as these gifts are given. We just pray that you would use them to the furthering of your kingdom. May people come to know you as a result. We pray in your name. Amen. Thine own, whate'er the gifts may be, all that we have is thine alone, a trust, O Lord, from thee. Amen. Please be seated. We'll call on the children at this time to come up for the children's message. If you'd like to come on up. You sure can. You can come up, Connor. I'm a child. So if people feel like... Hello there, bud. If you feel like a child today, you can come up too. So, boy, we're running out of space. You can come and sit. Some people can come sit up by me too if they want. So, this is kind of fun, isn't it? You can sit on the floor too if you want. You can sit on the floor. You can do whatever. We've started doing songs with the ABCs. Remember? Do you remember what the A song was last week? Remember what it was? Come on. No, the song. It's the name of a song. So. Yeah, Away in the Manger we did last week. So what would be a good song that begins with B that would teach us something about God? The B-I-B-L-E would be a good one, yeah. Anything else? Do you think they might know of some bee songs?
Yeah,
what are some good bee songs?
Beautiful
Savior would be a good one. Beneath the cross of Jesus, because he lives. Guess which one we're going to use today? Baby Shark.
No.
We're not going to sing it, because that gets kind of annoying sometimes, right? But, you know, sometimes when we hear songs, there's good truths there if we think about it, all right? What are the verses to Baby Shark? The first verse is Baby Shark, right? What's the second verse?
Mama
Shark. What's the third verse?
Daddy.
It's Dad Shark, right? And then third verse, or the fourth verse is Grandma, and the fifth verse is Grandpa Shark. Now, where's the biblical truth in Baby, Mama, Dad, Grandma, and Grandpa? Is there a good biblical truth there? Yeah.
Family.
Exactly, Oliver. Family. See, even a song that might annoy us to all ends, when you hear Baby Shark, you can go back to that biblical truth of God is the one who put together families, didn't he? Isn't that a big blessing that we've had, that we have families? Even if we've lost parts of our family, we still have those wonderful things that have been there for us. And so I want you to think of that the next time you hear the Baby Shark song, right before you plug your ears if you have to. Or if you sing the whole thing, because some kids love just doing it for the sake of doing it. You can be reminded that family is something God desires and has created. Think that's a good idea? So we've done A and B. Guess what? Next week we're going to do the letter C. So you can be thinking about different things that way, okay? Yeah, we'll keep working our way along, and we'll pick songs where we can learn some scriptural truths from. Let's pray. When you're done today, by the way, at the end of the service, you can grab two pieces of candy, but make sure you share one of them, okay? Okay, share one. Two. You can share two. That would be perfectly fine, Connor. Love hearing that. So let's pray. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for these dear young people, for their energy and for how you've made them, and we thank you for their families, families of all kinds. But Lord, we thank you that you are the one that gives us moms and dads, grandmas and grandpas, relatives of different kinds. We just pray that you'd be with each of these families, that you would do a work in each one. We pray in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. All right, guys. You guys can head down. Oh, there you go. We'll get the high fives later, too. We're very blessed today to have some very special, special music. So we're going to call upon Dale Bilberg's going to share a couple of songs with us right before the message, and then we'll jump into God's Word. So Dale, look forward to hearing you share.
Good morning. I'm glad I didn't pick Baby Shark for my song, but I'm going to stick with the bees because he lives for my first number. God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone.
Up there on the hill And I thank God for my lighthouse. I owe my life to Him, for Jesus is the lighthouse, and from the rocks of sin He has shone a light around me that I might clearly see. If it wasn't for the lighthouse, where would this ship be? And I thank God for the lighthouse. I owe my life to Him, for Jesus is the lighthouse, and from the rocks of sin He has shone His light around me that I might clearly see. If it wasn't for the lighthouse, where would this ship be?
Thank you so much, Dale, for singing those. And when we have the L letter, we should have you back for that lighthouse again. That's my dad's favorite song. And it's always a fun one to hear, to know that, that Jesus Christ is our lighthouse. There's no need of light in heaven because He will be the light. And we want to shine that light while we're here on earth. If you'd open your Bibles to Luke 9, as we continue on and finishing out, getting closer to finishing this chapter of Luke 9, we want to take a look at what has occurred here. And as we do that, I'm just going to set the stage a little bit. I've entitled this Three Answers, okay? Three Answers. If I could give it a semi-title underneath it, it'd be Three Human Questions and Three Godly Answers that are given to us here. And those will show forth in themselves that way. Now remember what's going on here with regards to things. The disciples have seen all these different things happening. The transfiguration has happened. Peter, James, and John were up with Jesus on the mountain. They've come down. Jesus has taken care of the evil spirit that was in the young boy that the disciples couldn't take care of. But we hit this part, and all of a sudden in verse 46, we see an argument get started with the disciples. They start arguing amongst one another there from verse 46. And we see that, and it makes sense in one sense because the disciples are thinking of Jesus as this Messiah that has come to be a political leader. They're thinking like the rest of things. Jesus has told them that the passion has to take place, that He has to die, but that's not registering with them. And now Peter, James, and John have gotten to go with Jesus specially up the mountain. And they come back down, and so now the disciples get a little argument amongst themselves. They start wondering who's going to get the better positions. Who are going to be the generals? Who are the ones that are going to have the better spots? Who's the greater of things? It reminds me of Winston Churchill one time. He was asked by someone that got him cornered. They said, "Doesn't it thrill you, Mr. Churchill, to know that every time you make a speech, the hall is packed to overflowing?" And Sir Winston Churchill replied, he said, "It's kind of flattering, but whenever I feel that way, I always remember that if instead of making a political speech, I was being hanged, the crowd would be twice as big." To be reminded of who we are. The disciples were wanting to climb the ladder. And Jesus
simply pulls out a child in front of them. The question here is, who is greater? The first question that we see in verses 46 through 48. And the answer that Jesus gives is the lesser. The least is the superlative that gets used here for who will be the greatest. Jesus pulls out the child, and he brings them again to that point of reminding them, as we will see in a bit here, about childlike faith. There was a Lutheran pastor one time who was continually bragging to his other minister friends about the greatness of his church. No matter what they said, he always found a way to claim that the Lutherans were better. Okay? Eventually, his friends got tired of it. They decided to play a prank on their Lutheran friend. So in his coffee, they put a little tablet one day, and he finished his coffee, and in a little bit, he fell asleep right there. They took him out to the graveyard, and they laid him in a borrowed coffin next to a freshly dug grave, and then they went and hid in the bushes to see what would happen when he would wake up. This is quite a thing, right? Half hour later, he wakes up, yawning, and he's looking around. He begins to notice the coffin, the tombstones, and the open grave, and then he shouts, "Amen! Hallelujah! Praise the Lord! The day of resurrection has come, and the Lutherans are the first ones out," he said. We get caught up thinking we're better or greater in things. Teddy Roosevelt, it said, would do this sometimes. William Beebe, the great naturalist, had a story about Teddy Roosevelt. They were at this place called the Sagamore Hill, and after an evening talk with one another, they would go out on the lawn and they would search the skies. And they would look for this certain constellation, the great square of Pegasus. You see it up there on the screen. Off to the bottom left of this would be this light, not a star, but it would be a light. And Teddy Roosevelt said this. He said, "That is the spiral galaxy Andromeda. It is as large as our Milky Way. It is one of 100 million galaxies. It consists of 100 billion suns, each larger than our sun." Then Teddy Roosevelt would get a grin on his face and he'd say, "Now I think we're small enough. Let's go to bed." Jesus brings out the little child to show them that to be great is to be less. Part of that, if we read the parallel passages to this, Jesus brings out the idea of childlike faith. To have childlike faith, to believe like a child. In fact, in Mark, he says, "Unless you have faith like a child, you can never enter the kingdom of God." We sang the Swedish song, "Tryggaräck och ingen vara," at the beginning, "Children of the Heavenly Father." This Swedish song's been running in my head all week, "Barna Tru." You ever heard the song "Barna Tru"? Any Swedes in here? I need somebody to translate for me when I sing it here, or try. Or I'm worried that I'm singing it wrong. But it goes like this. This is the way the first verse goes. "Har du kvar du barnet tru ifrån hemmet lugna bu kan du bedja an for som for du alltid bad Gud som haver barnen kor se till mig som listen or gamla morda karna sig så nöd och glad barnet tru. Barnet tro till himmelen du ör en gyllene bro. Barnet tro till himmelen du är en gyllene bro." Now, since I've sang in a tongue, I need an interpreter. Any interpreters? I looked it up. So here you go. Just, you know. Do you still believe in heart, nor from childhood faith depart? Can you pray as in the days of long ago? Lord, who loves the children all, keep me, guard me, though I'm small. Aged mother will rejoice with heart aglow. Childhood faith, childhood creed, a golden bridge to heaven you are indeed. Childhood faith, childhood creed, a golden bridge to heaven you are indeed. Now it comes down to Barna through. Jesus brings out that child to show that to his disciples, to have that simple childlike faith. To be great, Jesus shows them, is to have humility. Bertrand Russell was an atheist. He wrote books like, the book he wrote was Why I Am Not a Christian. And at the age of 81, he got interviewed by the BBC. And the radio talk show interviewer asked him, he was getting close to death, so they asked him, since you're getting so close to death, what are you going to hang on to when you die? And that's what Bertrand Russell said. I have nothing to hang on to but grim, unyielding despair. We need childlike faith. We need Jesus. We need to have that humility. That's what Jesus was talking to his disciples about. That they would know what it is to truly believe. Alex Haley was the man who wrote Roots. Maybe you, some of the older ones may remember that made it into that big movie and stuff. It is said that Alex Haley had a picture in his office up on the wall of a fence post with a turtle on top. Now, how did the turtle get on the fence post? Did he get up there himself? Alex Haley said this very thing. He said, if you see a turtle on a fence post, you know that he had some help. So Alex Haley would always say, when I started thinking, wow, isn't what I'm doing great and marvelous what I've done? He said, I would look over to that, and I would look at the picture and I remember how that turtle, how me, got up on the fence post. We need that help. In the book of James, it says, humble yourself in the sight of the Lord. And who will pick you up? Your neighbor? Your teacher at school? They might help you, but who's going to pick you up? The Lord will pick you up. He was showing his disciples and pointing them to that truth, that humility. Kids, you may recognize the name Booker T. Washington. Booker T. Washington was a man who was known as a scientist and was the founder of the Tuskegee Institute down in Alabama. He was a black man back in the days, so it was a pretty amazing thing down there. One day he was walking down the street and this wealthy white woman saw him and she said, hello there, can you come and do you need a job? Do you need to do something? You can cut this wood for me. I need this wood cut. Guess what Booker T. Washington did? He rolled up his sleeves and he went over. Should have been pretty offended, right? He's a major guy. He cut the wood for her, carried it all into the house, stacked it. In the house was a younger girl, and the girl recognized him. Later on that evening, that little girl told this wealthy white woman, that was Booker T. Washington. The next morning, she went over to Booker T. Washington's office and began to apologize profusely. And guess what Booker T. Washington did at that point? This is what he said. He said, "It's perfectly all right, madam. Occasionally I enjoy a little manual labor. Besides, it's always a delight to do something for a friend." That, my friend, is humility. We very often don't have much humility. We have a lot of pride that gets in the way. If you catch it there in verses 47 and 8, it says, "Whoever welcomes this little child," Jesus said, "welcomes me. And whoever welcomes me," Jesus said, "welcomes the one who sent me." Welcomes God. Now, when I bring all this up about receiving Jesus and things that way, are there times in your life where you just feel totally useless? You feel like, maybe you feel like this bucket that's up here on the screen here that'll be in just a second. An old bucket like this, where the staves are way out of whack and the wood pieces are things that way. How in the world can an old bucket that's broken up like that be any good anymore? One time there was a young man who saw a bucket like that. He could see light in between the things. And he's like, "That old bucket is no good." An elderly man picked up the bucket and threw it into the water. And the water made the wood swell. And the wood became useful again and the bucket could be used. How many of you out there feel kind of useless because you don't feel like you're the greatest? Who can use you? By the way, you don't have to be old and worn for that either, right? We can be used whether we're young or old. But if we are allowed to go into and welcome Jesus into our lives, He can fill us with water again. Now, that leads to the second part of our story here, doesn't it? I think what happens here is that the disciples start to think, hey, we got to make up for what Jesus is kind of getting after us here. And so in verses 49 and 50, you see James and John, they start to get a little bit, they say, "Master, hey, we saw someone casting out demons in your name and we tried to stop him because he doesn't follow us. He's not one of us." And Jesus says to him, "Don't stop him." You know what they were really asking? "Lord, did we do the right thing? Were we doing the right thing?" I think they were thinking they did the right thing because this guy wasn't a part of the 12. And Jesus says, "Don't stop him, for the one who's not against you is for you." Why did they do this? Because he wasn't one of them. We get so often caught today because somebody isn't one of us. Now, don't get me wrong. We're not talking about major doctrinal differences here. We're not talking about somebody teaching wrong stuff. This man was not teaching wrong stuff, because God doesn't want the wrong stuff taught. But what he was teaching and what he was doing was good things. Somehow, in the name of Jesus, demons were fleeing as he was doing those things. And the disciples thought, since he's not one of us. And Jesus reminds them, if they're not against us, they're for you. Now again, I don't want you to get caught with the wrong idea there, but I'm reminded of a church in Kentucky, Mayfield County, Kentucky. It was a Baptist church way back when. There was a church there, it was in the late 1800s. There were two deacons that were constantly struggling within the church for power. That never happens in churches, right? And they would go at each other. One day, one of the deacons put a peg up back behind near the pulpit so that the pastor could hang up his hat. The other deacon found out about it and said, "You didn't inquire from me. whether you could put that peg up there or not. The church split over it. Half of them were pegs and half of them were anti-pegs. In fact, they still call the two churches that became part of it Peg Baptist and Anti-Peg Baptist. They don't call them that officially in their names, but you laugh at that or something that way. There's been churches who have, they've split over the fact that they got indoor plumbing. I can tell you of a church in Wisconsin, when they got indoor plumbing, half the people left because they didn't want indoor plumbing. They wanted to keep the outhouse. That's the kind of things that go on. We have people who are, I think of the man who hired two high school boys each year to pick the corn that he had planted. They would pick the corn, they'd put it in the pickup truck for him. They would drive it into town, they'd sell it all, and they'd get half the profit. And these boys would work for him and do the things. And one day, as the boys were doing it, they're like, they told him, he said, somebody's been stealing your corn. He's like, no, no. And they showed him. There were footprints in the corn from somebody stealing. So the boys finished out the day, did what they're supposed to, brought the pickup back, and the man had thought during the day, he goes, hey, boys, I'll pay you more if you'll stick around tonight and catch these thieves. And the boys said, no, no, we've got things we've got to do tonight. And the two boys went alone. So the man thought, well, I'll do it. He took a shotgun with him that night and stood out there waiting for things. And he's waiting along, and all of a sudden, two people come. And he starts yelling at them. He doesn't want to shoot anybody, so he starts yelling at them so that they'll run away. They pick up clods of dirt and start throwing it at him. He picks up clods of dirt, starts throwing back. Finally, he just shoots the shotgun in the air, and the two just run off. The two boys come back to him the next day and say, we had a second thought about things. We decided to go out to help and find the person who was stealing your corn, but there was somebody out there and they were shooting at us. They had the same mission, didn't they? And they ended up throwing dirt at one another. Now, don't get me wrong, again, don't get me wrong. If people are not preaching Jesus as true God and the only way, that's a whole different story here. But so often we end up, it's like the story we read that I had Tim read in Numbers 11, Eldad and Medad. We never hear that story much. Those two guys were supposed to go to the tabernacle. They didn't. They stayed behind, and God put the Spirit of God in, and they began to prophesy. And some boys tell Moses about it, and Joshua gets all upset. He's like, you got to stop these guys, Moses. And Moses says, are you jealous for me? I wish that everybody could prophesy. First Corinthians 1, 10 through 13. You can skip ahead one, Kurt, on this one. Paul writes, he says, I plead with you, brothers, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you speak the same thing, that be no divisions among you, but you be perfectly joined together in the same mind, the same judgment. For it's been declared to me concerning you, my brothers, by some of Chloe's household, that there are some of you that say, I am of Paul, I am of Apollos, I am of Cephas, or I am of Christ. And Paul asks a question. He says, is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you, or were you baptized in the name of Paul? Who's the head of our family here? Who's the head of our church? Jesus. It's not Tim Fugelberg, even though he's one of the deacons. It's not me, Pastor Todd, as your pastor. It's Jesus. That's the divisions that were happening there. And Paul says, is Christ divided? He isn't. I love what he says in Philippians 1:18. Because there were people that were preaching about Jesus. And Paul writes in Philippians, he says, some of them preach out of spite for me. They preach Christ. They preach the right thing, but they preach it because they think it's going to cause me problems, Paul says. And there are some who preach it out of right motives. And Paul writes to the Philippians, he says, what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached. Not talking about false things preached, but if the motives are wrong, if Christ is preached, he says, and because of this I rejoice, and I'll continue to rejoice. As long as that truth is put out there. There was a man who took a trip to Israel, and he came to what's known as the Mann Auditorium in Tel Aviv. It's a beautiful place. He's looking at the wonderful structures. He got a tour of the place, beautiful decor throughout. And he asked the question of the tour guide. He said, is this building named for Thomas Mann, the world-famous author? And the man said, no. It's named for Frederick Mann from Philadelphia. Really? I've never heard of him. What did he write? Asked the tourist. A check, said the tour guide. He wrote a check. Jesus now is setting himself to go to Jerusalem to write the biggest check ever written, to pay the price. As he's going, we read it there in the next verses, that he's resolutely set. He's been telling his disciples, now the things are going to happen. The passion's going to take place in the next few months. As they go through Samaria. He sends people ahead because a big people are coming just to see. Samaritans don't like Jews. Jews don't like Samaritans. Samaritans are half Jewish. And we have all these things that go on. And many times the Samaritans would find out. They would allow people in to get the money, but sometimes if they found out they were going to Jerusalem, they would not accept them in. And that's what they did. Jesus and their crew, they said, no, because you're heading for Jerusalem. And you can almost picture it here. You can picture Jesus walking along, and now James and John, because this has happened, they walk up to Jesus. They walk on both sides of him and they say, Jesus, should we call down fire? Why did they want to call down fire? Now, when Tim read this today, Tim didn't read all the words that I have up there. If you look in your Bible, there's early readings of this or early manuscripts that have the extra words that are in there. Look at what it says. When James and John saw this, they asked the Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven and destroy them? When I read this, first of all, that's all that's in my NIV. There's a footnote underneath. I started to think, call down fire from heaven? Who called down fire from heaven? Elijah. Well, in the extra reading, it says, even as Elijah did. But Jesus turned and he rebuked them, it says. And then in the early manuscripts, it says this. And he said, you do not know what kind of spirit you are, for the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. Why did James and John want to call down fire from heaven? Because these Samaritans deserve judgment. They dissed Jesus by not allowing him to come through, not allowing him to stay there. And so they think they're doing a great thing at that moment. They deserve judgment. Now, when Tim read 1 Kings 18, why did Elijah call down fire from heaven? Did he call it down to take out everybody that was there? He called down fire so that everybody would know. That was his prayer, that the people may know that you, Lord, are God. And the fire came down and took up the whole altar that was there. It didn't come down to destroy people. See, I'm guessing that we feel like this sometimes, don't you? Don't you feel like you should call down fire because somebody's doing things wrong or against what God wants? Oh, don't tell me. You guys are all looking at me like, no. I know we've all felt the way that somebody deserves something. Wouldn't you just like to smuck somebody sometimes? God, I should be able to rightly schmuck that person. They thought that Jesus, they should be able to do that. But they missed it. And why not? Because Jesus came to save. Dennis Prager, years ago, interviewed high school kids. And he put this situation before him. He said, if you had the choice, who would you save first? If this something was happening, would you save your dog first or a stranger? Most of the kids said dog. Think about that answer. Why would they do that? Because they love their dog. What's more important? A human life, a human soul. That's how far we've gone. Because that's what is important. Jesus came to save. God desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Jesus is reminding them of that very fact. Jesus Matthew 5:44, Jesus said, love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you. And when Jesus was on the cross, we read in Luke 23, what did he say? To the very ones that were killing him, he said, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. That's why Jesus came. We don't deserve it, do we? We don't deserve it. But he came to save lives, to save our souls. I love the words in James chapter 2, verse 13. Judgment is without mercy to those who show no mercy, but mercy triumphs over judgment. 10 years after World War II, and I'm almost done here, so just hang on, it's getting warm up front here. That's why I keep walking this way. No. 10 years after World War II, there was a West German Christian that met with some Christians from Warsaw, Poland. He wanted to know if it'd be possible for a group of West German Christians to go to Poland to meet with these Christians to ask for forgiveness for all that had been done by the Germans during World War II. The Polish Christians said to the man, they said, we refuse to even consider such a meeting. The wounds are still too fresh. Every stone in Warsaw is stained with Polish blood from a German bullet or a bayonet. We just can't do this. We can't even consider it. The German Christian accepted the answer, but he asked, he said, before we go, can we at least just pray the Lord's Prayer together? And they agreed to the request and they began to pray the Lord's Prayer. When they got to the part that says, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us, there was silence. They couldn't go on. Because then the Polish Christians who had been so vehement in their rejection, they said, this is difficult, but I can't begin to forgive. I can't even pray that prayer. Within the next year, they began the healing process and had the West Germans come and ask for forgiveness. See, Jesus has offered this to us, hasn't he? He showed the disciples what it is to have childlike faith. To be less is to be the servant. To be less, to be humble is the way. And then he showed them the grace of God. If they aren't against us, they're for us. If they're preaching that right stuff, it doesn't matter that they aren't like us. And then in that last part, they wanted to call down fire, and Jesus said, have mercy, is really what he said. And that's the very thing he's showing to us. When he went to the cross, he paid the check, the price for us. That's the call that he has to each of us today. Let's pray. Lord, you use your word. Take what you've done and help each of us with that childlike faith to believe. And when we start thinking too highly of ourselves, Lord, remind us that you are the one that we worship. You are the one who's paid that price. You are the one who has put us as turtles up on the fence post, because we can't be saved in ourselves. Thank you, Lord. You do your work. In your name, Jesus, I pray. Amen. As a closing song, I thought about this fact that just to be reminded of all the blessings we do have. So let's be some mathematicians for a bit today. Let's stand together and let's count our blessings and what the Lord has done for us. Let's pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And may the Lord himself bless each of you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, the one true and living God. Amen and amen. Thank you.